Way over there is Drumden. It's one of the newer towns in these polders, and that town wasn't there about 10 years ago. It was still water then, and after the polders have been drained, that town was erected. And in that town, there is a special memorial dedicated to all airmen which died for the liberation of Europe during the war. And how that monument came there is, in fact, the story apart, because everywhere in the Netherlands, in the evening of the 4th of May, there is a remembrance to remember our war dead. But in this new town, which was not there during the war, they didn't have anything. So because the Air Force had been digging up all the aircraft here and finding to the missing airmen, they said, well, our link with the war are those airmen. And they asked the Air Force if we could provide anything to put up a memorial. And just about that time, we had found a Lancaster aircraft. There was a propeller, which was, in fact, a beautiful shape for a monument. And that was presented to the town of Drumden, and they erected a memorial.
The Dutch started to reclaim land from the Zuider Zee, the present IJsselmeer. And when recovering these new polders, the sea was in fact laid dry. And as soon as the sea bottom becomes visible, you find all kinds of relics, ships from the Middle Ages, and also aircraft. More than 7,000 aircraft went down in the years between 1939 and 1945. And the Air Force was called in, it's an international agreement in fact, to recover these wrecks.
My name is Jerry Swanenburg. I'm an identification and salvage officer of the Netherlands Air Force, and I'm in charge of excavating and identifying any aircraft records that might be found in Holland, not only in the new polders but also elsewhere. But our main work is in fact in the polders, because during the war many aircraft crashed into these areas. The first I did hear about this particular aeroplane was from the Department of Waterways, who in turn did learn it from the fishermen. Because when the fishermen went fishing on the IJsselmeer, they sometimes did hook the nets on aircraft records and damage them. In order to get the repay for the damage to the nets, they in turn had to report it to the Department of Waterways. And then the Department of Waterways, responsible for a clean sea bottom, sent out a ship, the North Holland, to investigate. The Department of Waterways closed the dikes around South Friesland in October 67, and they started draining the pumping station, pumped out every minute 3,000 cubic meters of water. The water level went down in the polder 1.5 up to 2 millimeters each day. They finished draining in August 1968, and a new polder of about 125,000 acres was added to the land of Holland. Pilots flying from Soesterberg flew out regularly for a reconnaissance flight to see if any records might be sticking out of the mud. And as soon as they saw something, they reported it to me, and then I flew out myself. I have been there a few times, and I have had a look at the records from the air, and I think she might have been a Stirling, but I'm sure that she's an RAF aeroplane. As soon as the polder is dry, the Department of Waterways sews in reed to make the ground firm, because the ground is still very soft. And you can't get in any tractors. The roots suck out the water and make the ground firm, and after a couple of years, you can easily go in with your equipment.
ought to know whether it's a Wellington, a Halifax, a Stirling, or, for instance, German or an American aircraft. Usually you can find some bits and pieces which are recognizable to a certain aircraft, but most of the time, too, you have only small pieces and not secondary to anyone. So then I have to look, and it's the more sure way, too, to the part numbering, because in the part numbering of the parts, which are usually stamped in, and so with a little bit of sending, you'll find them, the aircraft type is incorporated.
5-3-4-7-1-1-2. En heel belangrijk, SHB met een nummer. We hebben een short Stirling.
News came to the Air Historical Branch in London through the Air Attaché in the Netherlands that Jerry Zwanenburg had uncovered pieces of a Stirling aircraft in the Polder. Jerry believed, from local information, that the aircraft had crashed about the middle of May 1943. We could very quickly sort out from Bomber Command reports on night operations which Stirlings had been lost in May 1943. From our 300,000 aircraft record cards and operations record books, we were able to eliminate all but a handful of possible aircraft. But to make a positive identification, Jerry Zwanenburg had to come up with an airframe serial number and an engine number married up on that particular piece of wreckage.
The reeds are burned down before cultivation gets started. See, when the reeds are sown in, the roots are very useful to get land dry, but once you have to cultivate, it's only a nuisance. But after the reeds have been burned down, we start in to clear the area of the wreckage, bombs and ammo, which can endanger a farmer plowing the land afterwards. One of the first things we do when the reeds have been burned down is mark all the pieces of wreckage, because we know from experience that the reeds can go again very fast and close the wreckage off from fuel.
This is a fisherman's weight. As you see, this is where the chain was on. Fishermen use it to weigh down their nets, and these kind of things get hooked onto the aircraft parts on the bottom, and that's how we got our spots on the map.
This is 0.303 MO. They could carry up to 15,000 rounds, and this can be very dangerous still, and that's one of the main reasons why this work has to be done.
Well, this is the aft part of the fuselage. What you see here is the tailplane has been sitting here. She has been broken, and when you see up there, you can see the contours of the tail turret.
This is part of the oxygen system, and it's remarkable how good things are preserved under the water and under the mud for so many years. But this particular Stirling was carrying a full load of incendiaries, and she might have been on the way back because all the bomb containers are empty. Miles of ditches had to be dug on the area where the wreckage was lying to get the surface water out. The ground here is still below sea level, and when we are digging, the groundwater is seeping up, and as we are digging down, the holes are filled up with water, and we have to keep the water pump going all the time to keep our holes clear.
Ain't no bad, Booker.
Well, normally a job like this, a 4-engine bomber like this Stirling, will take about 4 to 6 weeks, depending on the weather and depending on what you'll find. Sometimes, well, this one is smashed really to pieces, but all the engines are more or less in one part, and they weigh about a ton, complete with mud and something like that, and you have to move in your heavy equipment to get them out. I always look for the engine numbers because they are very important for a full identification of the aircraft. I know where the number plate should be on the engine, but they are not always there, as they might have broken off in the crash.
Yes, this is it, 90 Squadron. 12th, 13th May, 1943. Sterling, 3. BF 523. This aircraft took off at 0030 hours and failed to return.
These last 5 minutes, or how did it happen, in fact? And in many cases, we really succeed in giving a reconstruction how the aircraft crashed, what happened, how the impact was, and was it a sudden kill or not?
This is Frank Phillips reading it. Last night, a strong force of bombers attacked the road, inflicting heavy damage on enemy installations. Although our casualties are not yet known, they are understood to be light.
After a number of years when recovering these aircraft, we started in fact to establish that there was still a very different other point which is of enormous importance, and that's the point of missing aircrew. In the beginning, we found missing aircrew when we tried to identify them afterwards, after the whole operation was closed. But we learned very soon that having a relative still missing and not knowing where he went down and what happened to him seems still to be a very important thing. think, sometimes an obsession for the family at home. And after bringing home a couple of names of missing aircrew, we found that really this personal or human aspect of the thing is of even the more importance than cleaning a small part of ground.
De eerste plaats van de stoffelijke resten in de polder.
I am responsible, firstly, for finding the remains of the airmen in the polders, and secondly, for identifying them and their personal belongings. This is a very difficult, heavy and muddy job. After the digging has taken place, I start identifying the men with the help of the medical records which I receive from London through Mr. Swanenburg.
Geschied aan de hand van de medische geheimen.
Mrs. Connie, would you please get me the medical records of these three airmen? You'll find them in the war period. Go.
In this particular case, we did find some of the crew, and that means meaning quite a lot of handwork. You can't move in with heavy equipment because you're destroying all those tiny small parts. And I expect this job to be at least 8 weeks. The primary thing is, in this kind of land, to remove ammunition, bombs, and that kind of thing, because you might not endanger farmers working on the land later on. And that's one of the things that started us off. But then again, the crew members became very important because quite a lot of them were missing. And to help to identify them, ammunition is very important because on every shell there is stamped on the year in which it was made. From experience, we know that, say, for instance, ammunition of 1942 was used from July 1942 until June 1943, giving me a rough indication of at what time the airplane crashed. We are lucky in so far that she crashed in one spot, because she came in from great height. But when she comes in low level, you'll find it over a much bigger distance. And in this time, it's quite concentrated, making the work for us, in fact, easier.
Even at this late stage, we're still finding ammunition. And I expect that when we have finished this job entirely, we might have found up to 10,000 rounds.
Yeah? Get a buck?
It's a wide, open and flat country now. But in a few years' time, a lot of people will be working and living right here.
It was a big raid with more than 450 aircraft. For 90 Squadron, casualties were not light. They lost two aircraft out of the 13 they sent. The names of their lost crews, along with thousands of others who, like them, have no known grave, are recorded on the Commonwealth Air Force's memorial here at Runnymede, beside the Thames.
If you didn't learn fast enough, you didn't learn.
Yeah.
And my first two trips were the worst trips I ever had.
Yeah, but let's face it, crews came pretty fast and furious those days.
Particularly at that time with the Battle of the Ruhr. The losses were
fairly hard. I mean, we knew a lot of chaps as Tom, Dick, Harry, Fred, but when you mention their surnames, it doesn't mean anything.
These are pursuit lines, and that might mean that some of the crew might be lying underneath. This means too that we have to be very careful excavating this part of the aircraft, not to destroy any indications on that.
Sometimes. sometimes you come back and you've had a shaky do, and the rest of the crews, or some, most of the crews have really had the proverbial bit of cake, you know, and they wonder what all this is about when you start shooting a bit over the line. So some raids, of course, you go through with no trouble at all, and other times you're getting all the trouble in the world.
As well as a bottle of oxygen still in the pressure, they monitor the bottle, and these are the small operanta which they use in the aircraft. Other things will go to museums, in particular to the RAF machine. And from the guns, this gun will go to the RAF museum too, of course, after it has been cleaned by the officers of the Netherlands Air Force. And that really ends up the story, because the rest of the aircraft is in fact sold for scrap. It's a bit sad, but that's it. Completed, and we found ample proof of the identity of the aircraft in the engine numbers, as well as the serial number of the aircraft, which was painted inside of the engine cowling. And some other things came out as well. We found part of the crew, and some things are related to them, just like this oxygen mask.
The crew of BF 523 are buried in Holland. They were Sergeant A.J. Buxton, mid-gunner, age 26. Sergeant W. Murray, air bomber, age 24. Sergeant C. Green, rear gunner, age 24. Sergeant E.W. Eek, wireless operator, age 20. Sergeant B.M. Bacon, navigator, age 20. Sergeant W. Morey, pilot, age 20. Sergeant C. Shaw, flight engineer, age 19.
This is the BBC in London. Here is the news. In the early hours of this morning, RAF Bomber Command launched a major raid on Berlin. Of the 596 aircraft which took part in the raid, 46 are missing.
The Nazis entered this war under the rather childish delusion that they were going to bomb everybody else and nobody was going to bomb them. At Rotterdam, London, Warsaw, and half a hundred other places, they put that rather naive theory into operation. They sowed the wind, and now they are going to reap the whirlwind.
We'll be right back.
They fell like crippled birds from Holland's limited skies. Nearly 7,000 aircraft, Allied and German, more than lost anywhere else in the European war. Geography dictated their path over Holland. The Germans waited with guns and fighter pilots. They met, they fought desperately. Losses were tragic. The Allies kept coming by day and night. Those who crashed on land were the known statistics of war. Of those 7,000, it is estimated that hundreds more disappeared below the icy waters of Holland's inland sea, the IJsselmeer. The fate of their airmen held secret for years, a laconic missing, their only requiem. RAF night bombers were ordered to fly direct to Germany over Holland. 3,000 fell as the Nazis met them with their best fighter squadrons and long-range guns. To hit Germany by day, the Americans chose the same route. Few thought they could succeed. Among them, Air Chief Marshal Bomber Harris.
I was very doubtful, after our experiences, that the bomber would get through in daylight. They had heavier machine guns than we had.